This is a mock-up of a type of belt drive called a crowned pulley, and it behaves in a really counterintuitive way. It's worth disambiguating the word pulley at this point. Like, when you think of the word pulley, you think of that device that redirects force or multiplies a force. For example, a snatch block.
Snatch block.
This isn't the snatch block type of pulley.
Snatch block!
It just so happens that in the world of belt drives, this part and this part are called pulleys. The thing that distinguishes a crowned pulley is this curved profile here. What's surprising and counterintuitive about the crowned pulley is that the band doesn't slip off. Like, if I place the band off center like this, you would expect that when I start to turn it, it will slip further and further until it leaves the pulley altogether. Like, if I pull a rubber band against an inclined surface, it slides down the incline. But let's see what happens with the crowned pulley. It's quite the opposite. The band moves back towards the middle of the pulley. How can that be? This isn't just a curiosity, it's actually really useful. I asked Tom Lipton if he had any machines with a crowned pulley. He very kindly sent me this video of his belt sander. You might recognize Tom from a collaboration I did with him on air bearings. Link to that video and his channel in the description and in the card. It's worth just checking our intuition. Why do we think the rubber band should slip off? Well, rubber bands are stretchy. When you pull them, they pull back. You feel a restoring force. If you'll permit me to anthropomorphize the rubber band, when you extend it, it wants to be short again. If you won't permit me to anthropomorphize the rubber band, let's say that a shorter rubber band is energetically favorable. But either way, you can see that as the rubber band slips down the pulley, it gets shorter, and that's more energetically favorable. So we should expect that to happen. It's a bit like a ball on the top of a hill. It's an unstable equilibrium. If you push it a little in one direction, it should roll all the way down the hill. Except that doesn't happen in this case. Our intuition is wrong. I want to say at this point that when you reach the end of this video, you should go and check out Matthias Wandel's channel. He made a video about crowned pulleys 11 years ago. I don't tend to make videos that have already been covered by other people unless I can add something, and I feel like I can in this case. But anyway, Matthias makes some really interesting builds, and you should check out his channel. The link is in the card and the description. To understand why the crowned pulley behaves the way it does, consider what happens to a rubber band when you stretch it, but only holding on to one edge. You'll notice that the band arches. This part ends up higher than it was before, and you have a curve here and here. You can see on the crowned pulley that this edge is more stretched than this edge, so we should expect the rubber band to curve upwards here. It's very subtle because the difference in stretch between the two edges is quite small in this case, but it is there. Because of that upward curve of the rubber band, when you turn the crowned pulley, it comes into contact with a piece of rubber band that is higher than the rubber band that's already on the pulley, and so it slowly shifts upwards. Just to prove that it is a belt effect, here's a rubber band that is as wide as it is thick, and you'll notice it does eventually slip off. We should also expect the opposite counterintuitive effect. If the profile has a concave curve, the rubber band should ride up one of the sides when we intuitively expect it to be drawn into the middle. And look, that's exactly what we find. I actually think the bowing effect is easier to see on this one. And just for completeness, here's a thin elastic band in the concave pulley not doing the thing. One question we haven't answered yet is, why does the rubber band bow when it's stretched from one edge? Well, you know me, I like to build physical models of things, so I've created this network of springs. It's not a perfect analogy for a rubber band because, well, it's a discretization of the rubber band. Like, a rubber band is a continuum of springiness, but we have discrete springs here. But in any case, when you pull on the topmost row of springs, eventually these two springs here begin to pull on the second row of springs. And so now these seven springs are being pulled into a straight line. And as that line of strings straightens, it pushes up on these four springs. And those springs push upwards on the top row of springs, and so they bow upwards. But actually, why are elastic bands stretchy in the first place? Why do they pull back? Surprisingly, it's because of entropy. You might know that elastic bands are made of rubber, which is a polymer. In other words, long chain molecules, like these long chains of beads here. So this is a kind of model for the polymer. You'll notice that all the chains are jumbled up, just like in an elastic band when it's not stretched. When you stretch an elastic band, you line up those long chains like this. So why isn't our model of an elastic band contracting when we let go? Well, it's because our model doesn't have any heat yet. Heat is just molecular jiggle. So I can add heat to this model just by jiggling the chains with my hands. And you'll notice that when I do so, the ends contract inwards, just like a rubber band. The reason atomic jiggle causes the chains to become jumbled up is because the jumbled up state has higher entropy, and systems tend towards higher entropy. The reason the jumbled state is higher entropy, and the reason systems tend towards higher entropy, would require a whole video to explain. Fortunately, I've already made that video. The link is in the card and the description. I hope you check it out. But isn't that cool? The reason an elastic band stretches back is because of an entropic force.
Snatch block!
It's not a snatch block, right? I want to tell you about a Blinkist feature that I've been using a lot more recently. Blinkist are sponsoring this video. Blinkist is an app that does something remarkable. It condenses non-fiction books into 15-minute reads. They're also audio narrated, so you can listen to them on your commute. It's just a great way to consume a lot of information very quickly. You know, famous people often give book recommendations. Blinkist has this feature called collections, and it's different collections of books. And some of them are what they call expert picks. For example, here are all the books that Elon Musk has recommended: 0 to 1, Life 3.0, The Big Picture, and so on. And there's loads of collections like that. They also have collections like This Is Cryptocurrency, with books like Crypto Assets, The Age of Cryptocurrency, Life After Google, Ethereum, and that sort of stuff. So yeah, collections are a great way to explore the titles that they have. You may remember I recommended Tim Harford's books a while back. He's got a new one now that's on Blinkist as well. It's called The Data Detective. I recommend you check that one out too. The first 100 people to go to my special URL, blinkist.com/Steve Mould, will get 1 week absolutely free, so you can try it out, see if it's for you. If it's not for you, there's no strings attached, but if it is for you, you get 25% off full membership. The link is also in the description, so check out Blinkist today. Thank you to Meteor Oven for the idea for this video, and thank you to Patrick Hurd for the 3D printed parts. The YouTube algorithm thinks you'll enjoy this video next, so why not give it a try? Go on, try it.